for our actual presentation here, we actually gave a presentation at our company. We work for a startup in the commercial real estate tech space that's based in downtown Denver called Apto. We basically make software for real estate brokers. So our day job wasn't really related to crypto. And when we went to give a presentation about what we had, you know, left the job to go do for a weekend, the reception wasn't exactly that great because people didn't really necessarily have the same level of understanding of crypto across it. So we thought that there's a big need for really describing the fundamentals of blockchain in a really easy and digestible way so that people who aren't involved in the space can get involved better, especially if they don't really have a familiarity with the technical side. And to really put the space in context with a lot of the other inventions and innovations that have happened in cryptography and kind of computer science in general. And so that's the focus of our talk today. So we kind of have a broad range of people with expertise in the room. Some people who work on this as their day job for a living, and some people who are just interested and want to show up. And so we wanted to make sure that we were giving a presentation that's interesting for everyone. So for the people who are just here to learn and haven't really seen much of the crypto space, kind of just follow along with our presentation. We're going to be explaining things in pretty deep detail as where necessary, but kind of simplifying things where needed. And for people who are very deep into the crypto space already and might know some of this stuff, maybe think a little bit about how not only we can improve this presentation, but maybe how it might make your conversations with other people who aren't involved in the space a little easier and a little more informative for them. So really kind of growing this space and being broad with the way we communicate. So that's why we call this blockchain fundamentals. And we're also going to talk at the end about a little cool project that we did at ETH Denver. Hopefully more of it's going to be spent on the explanation part of the day. So our agenda is a pretty simple little 5-bullet point here, which I'll let Becca describe kind of the understanding of what we wanted to talk about.
Sure. So first, what the fuck is crypto? It's kind of tricky to get into, so we're going to dive into that. Blockchain, some many parts. Then we're going to go over Bitcoin and Ethereum, and then jump from there into our Ethereum project.
Yeah, so at any point, we're going to kind of go through, and the slides are all kind of titled for the sections. So we'll kind of pause at the end of each section if you guys have clarifying questions or people want to ask, you know, each other about specifics. Hopefully, we'll cover most of the high points, but if there's anything we missed, especially for those of you guys who are very deep into this space and you want to point it out and make sure that it gets noted, feel free to contribute and talk to us.
Cool.
Let's
start.
So to start off here, you know, crypto, right? It's a word. It's an abbreviation. There's a lot of words that end in crypto. You know, cryptocurrency, cryptozoology, if you maybe you're into the whole Bigfoot thing. Cryptography, of course. And there's lots of very intimidating words in this space, especially for someone who's never seen blockchain, seen crypto, seen this technology. So if you look at this word cloud here, I'm sure people who are familiar with network protocols and a lot of the more fundamental stuff understand a lot of these words. But if I read this list here out to Michael's parents here, I don't know how many of you of these words you guys are super familiar with, because they're pretty dense, pretty jargon-packed, and while they do have very important meaning and are very strongly needed in this space, it's not important to really understand the true deep details unless you're actually working on the technology. But really understanding that, hey, maybe this is kind of intimidating, and let's simplify it a little bit and make sure that we are touching on the things that are really important. So crypto, you might know of encryption, the classic process of coding messages and decoding. So this is something that I think most people are familiar with, the classic practice of armies and militaries perhaps having a message that they need to send with a courier to their troops on the front line. And they might scramble up the message, they might substitute B's for E's, for example, and code their message, send it on the courier so that if the enemy captures their courier, they wouldn't be able to know what the plans were for the troops. So this encryption has been really the key component that led to the development of cryptography as a wider field of computer science, and in turn led to cryptocurrencies and crypto, which we'll kind of get into a bit. So think Alan Turing and the Enigma machine when you think about encryption and crypto. So their goal with building the Enigma machine, so some of you have probably seen the Imitation Game or some of the more popular culture references to this, was to decode the messages that the Nazis were sending via their sort of unencrypted wavelengths. To figure out, okay, well, how can we actually go through, capture these messages, and understand what the Nazi plans are so that we could better react in World War II? And so the Enigma machine was just one such way that they were able to finally crack the code and figure out how the Nazis were scrambling their messages so that we could ultimately, on the Allied side, finish off World War II successfully. So encryption has a pretty important connotation in that sense, but that's sort of the roots of where a lot of this cryptography and crypto stuff comes from. It's encryption and then many, many things that follow from it. So to more formally define cryptography, cryptography is the practice and study of techniques for secure communication in the presence of third parties called adversaries. So keeping in mind this concept of an adversary, that there's someone who might have a vested interest in listening into your secret communications, is very, very important, especially as we talk more about the security of the blockchain space and understanding the technology that underpins it and why it's important. So adversaries, think about that. We have lots of adversaries in this world who may be listening in on our communications, and it's very important to make sure that we're aware and we're protecting ourselves from these adversaries.
So an example we used, it's often used, the Alice and Bob explanation. So Alice wants to send a message to Bob. Whether it's encrypted or not, there could be Eve, the eavesdropper, who can listen in, somehow break into what you're doing, figure out what your secret message is. Long story short, cryptography is how people get things done when they need one another, don't fully trust one another, and have adversaries actively trying to screw things up. So that's kind of the theme of how we're continuing this presentation.
But crypto is so much more than just encryption. Crypto has a lot of really interesting inventions and advancements that have taken place within the space. I know we have some Zcash enthusiasts back here who I'm sure are familiar with some of these. But there are lots of really important innovations and inventions that have come out of the cryptography space, particularly things like public key encryption, which has powered the development of the internet as we know it, and a lot of our open networking models, signatures, deniable encryption, homomorphic encryption, zero knowledge proofs, of course, being very important with stuff like Zcash. Secure multi-party computation, obfuscation of programs, so you know, hiding stuff from people, and one pretty neat new one that I think we're all here to talk about, which just may happen to be blockchain.
So, blockchain, some of the many parts. How we send money online now. The idea of this is to talk about what we're doing with money online, with digital money. Currently, if Alice wants to send money to Bob, she can use a few things. There's this new app called Venmo. PayPal, you can use the bank, using your bank, going through your bank. Same thing with this Visa example here. Is it really safe to trust these third parties? That's a question you can ask. What do you guys think?
Yes.
Dad and Bridges.
I think we've seen exactly how harmful it can be when one trusted third party has personal and private information. And specifically with this money example, having any sort of third party that has control of your money. The crypto space is obviously much bigger than just money, but we like to use the money example because that was the original killer app for crypto in general. It's this idea that, hey, maybe you could actually send value over the network. Do you trust these people with your money when Equifax can take your social security number and dump it out and ruin your credit and all these fun things? Probably not. So trusting these third parties is a little sketchy, and we'd like to avoid that.
So how can Alice send money online to Bob with no third party involved? First, we would need digital money, right? Traditional money is paper or metal. We would need to move a third party, or we would need a third party to move it for us. We can never natively send offline money online. There's always trust involved, so there's always a company taking care of it. So for this example, let's just make up our own digital. What would happen if she sends digital money over the public internet?
We know Eve can show up here and eavesdrop on our connection, and that's one of the really dangerous things about creating any sort of digital money. So it can be picked up by someone. Man, that's a little dangerous.
Right.
So how do we keep it safe and secret? Well, we talked a little bit earlier about how we can code our messages and encode them and use this classic cryptographic technique of encryption. That's an important tool that we have available. So. Maybe with our fake digital money, we could encrypt it. That'd be a great idea to keep it safe and secure.
Great, done, right? We have created digital money with no consequences. Wrong, not done. So what if Bob copies the message and tries to claim he's received double the money?
If Alice sent a message to Bob that says, hey Bob, I'm paying you one of my digital monies, what prevents Bob from saying, well, now I have a message from Alice that says she sent me one digital money. I just copy that, say she sent me two. Or three, or four. We can copy files, because files, by their very nature, are copyable in the same sense that, you know, if you have an MP3 file and you want to send it to someone, you can copy it very easily. You don't have to get rid of it in order to send it to someone else. And that's one of the fundamental principles of money, at least money in circulation. That stuff's not exactly copyable. Well, it is copyable, but it's a federal offense to do so. So generally not advised to be running a counterfeiting operation. But being able to send these things back and forth while still keeping it is one of the really interesting advantages of computing and file management in general. You can keep a copy and send something to someone else. But with money, that doesn't work, because if I can copy the money and send it to someone else, that's a problem, because then everyone has money, right?
Everyone's a billionaire.
Everyone's a billionaire. We can't prove that Alice has only sent the initial amount. Alice herself could just go ahead and say, well, I have one digital money certificate now, right? I can make myself a billionaire. I can just copy that as many times as I want, and I can have as much money as I want. And we have this huge problem, which, to those of you who are more familiar with the crypto space, would know as the double spend. This idea that being able to copy your money shouldn't be possible. There should be some insurance against copying.
So we need a global source of truth. And wouldn't that mean that someone or some company has to keep the record?
So imagine that spreadsheet here, right? So maybe if we wanted to keep track of how much money Alice and Bob had, if we kept track that Alice has 15 and Bob has 24, in like some global spreadsheet of some sort, be really nice, because then we can know, hey, if Alice sends 5 to Bob, we can take 5 off of her account, and we can add 5 to Bob's account. That way we can preserve the total amount of money in circulation, but we can know who has what at any given time. The only problem is, who's going to maintain the spreadsheet? Well, probably a third party, right? A bank, Visa, any sort of PayPal type system. They're going to have to be keeping track of who owns what. And everyone's going to have to agree that someone's in charge. Problematic.
What if everyone kept a copy and agreed on the rules for updating it? So as you can see here, both Alice and Bob have a copy of this ledger.
We just described, in basic terms, a blockchain. This idea that everyone can have a copy of this ledger, and that they, instead of agreeing to trust a third party, like a Visa or a PayPal, agree on shared rules for updating their copy, and agree to a set of protocols and systems for updating that in a fair and agreed upon way. So, definition-wise.
A blockchain is an open, distributed ledger that can record transactions between parties efficiently in a verifiable and permanent way.
And it would be very, very key to make sure this is permanent. Yeah. Because we don't want someone to have their own copy and go through and say, well, I don't like the fact that Bob has a copy of the ledger that says I have less money than now, so I'm going to change the ledger. We have to make sure we come up with a series of rules that would cause us as a group to collectively say, hey, Alice, you're cheating. You're trying to give yourself more money than you have. You actually only have this because everyone else in the network gives this. So, what is blockchain? Well, I heard this described to me by a fairly non-technical person, and I laughed a lot because I thought it was actually kind of directionally accurate. So, what is blockchain? Like a big-ass global spreadsheet that everyone shares? Kind of, in a way. It's more that everyone has their own version of the spreadsheet, and they have to agree and collaborate on updating it. So I think that's an interesting way to look at it is, for those of you who are more familiar with financial jargon and whatnot, ledgers, keeping track of who has what at what point in time, you know, a general ledger, a balance sheet for a company, those kinds of things, have existed since the dawn of time for tracking things. We've invented double entry accounting way back when, and that's been fairly useful for us as a society to keep track of where money is. And it's not super hard to imagine a business that keeps track that, hey, we received a check from a friend, and then we paid out another friend, and so on and so forth, and have this sort of chronological history that, you know, on the 20th of April, 2015, we received a check, and on the 21st, we paid out, and so we add some here and subtract some here and keep track of a total balance, but ultimately we have these various transactions that we're trying to keep a historical record. So you can envision doing that in a spreadsheet where you're keeping track of them one by one. There are many, many reasons that in cryptocurrency space, that's not the easiest solution. So blockchain is a lot like that, but better. So picture a data structure where entries can only be added, but not deleted. That's something very important, because we don't want someone to go back and rewrite history to change the fact that they had done something previously. Because if Alice can go back and say she had 20 instead of 15, then we haven't preserved the integrity of the system. And no one can really trust the system because Alice has made changes to it. We want anyone to be able to keep their own copy, because if you are receiving a payment from Alice, you want to be able to check and make sure that Alice does have the money that she's claiming to have. So being able to keep your own copy independently verified, that what is going on has actually occurred to the rules is extremely important. That there are also shared rules for modifying it, so that everyone agrees on who gets the right to add to it, you know, who gets to add a new record to the end of it. That might be one particular person, that might be the network as a whole, but making sure that you have shared rules for actually mutating this. And that cheating is easily detected and reported.
So I'll do an example too. If I had a copy of this global list, basically, and Dylan has a copy, and Michael has a copy, and on my copy I say, everyone can see that I've given Michael $15. If I change that and I say I've given Michael $1, these two can say to me, like, hey, no, we're going to overrule you, you lose. You know? So really, like, that's how it works, is that cheating doesn't happen because there's so many other copies that keep everyone else in line.
Exactly.
How does this all work?
So what we do in order to make this work, and we'll get into a slightly deeper explanation for those of you more technically minded folks in a second, but we combine a lot of these cool inventions that have come out of cryptography to create a system. So when you think about blockchain relative to crypto as a wider space, it's really a bunch of these different innovations from cryptography coming together to create a living, breathing system that allows us to maintain this data structure, this blockchain, and make sure that it grows and that it stays secure. So public key cryptography, hashing, and signatures are three of those earlier ones that we talked about. There are different crypto assets that use lots of other interesting tech, you know, zero-knowledge proofs, ZK-SNARKs, stuff like that. But combined, we call this system blockchain. It's all these different pieces. So we're going to launch first here into probably what for me was a really enlightening thing as far as understanding how blockchain works, especially with regard to some of the specific crypto technologies. This guy, Anders Brown, actually created a very interesting video that describes sort of how you arrive at this concept of the blockchain, how it's immutable, and why it works the way that it does. It's about a 17-minute video, but it's extremely interesting, and I think it does a pretty
this
good job
blockchain.
Of explaining things on a fairly simple and easy to understand. So even those of you who are non-technical should hopefully be able to follow.
This is a blockchain demo. We're going to do this in a very visual way, though. We're going to make it very easy to understand by stepping through the key pieces of what a blockchain is in a visual way. But before we get started, we need to take a look at this thing that we call a SHA-256 hash, okay? And a hash, this is one of them right here. A hash looks like a bunch of random numbers. And essentially what it is, it's a fingerprint of some digital data. And it just so happens, it's a fingerprint of whatever I type in this box. So if I type my name, Anders, into this box, you see that the hash has changed. As a matter of fact, it changed every time I typed a letter, right? I'm going to go back to, so it says Anders. Okay, so this is the hash of the name Anders, all lowercase. It starts with 19EA, right? Okay, so if I delete that, and I go again, type Anders again, you can see it starts with 19EA, the same exact hash. In that sense, it's a digital fingerprint of this data. Whatever data is here, every time you type exactly the same data, you get exactly the same hash. And I can type anything I want. So I can even have nothing, like this, you know, E3B0, that's the hash of nothing. Or you could type tons and tons of stuff. As a matter of fact, you could put like the Library of Congress in here and you would get a hash. And the interesting thing about it is, regardless of if there's a tiny amount of information, no information, or the entire Library of Congress, you're always gonna get a hash that is this long, this many characters. So you're not gonna be able to pre-guess what this is. You kind of have to put the Library of Congress in here to figure out what the hash is, but you'll always get exactly the same hash regardless of how many times you put exactly the same information in. So what I'm going to do is extend this idea of a hash into something that we're going to call a block. All right, so let's take a look at a block. So this is a block, and it's exactly like the hash, it's just that the data section I've broken out now into three sections. One called block, this is just some kind of a number, this is block number one. A nonce, which is just yet another number, we'll go into what that is in a second. And then just some more data, just very similarly to the way that we had it before. However, cache of this, which includes all of this information up here, is down here, and it begins with four zeros. You see that? That's a relatively unusual hash. You know, most of them are not really going to start with four zeros like that, but this one happens to. And because it does, totally arbitrarily, I'm going to say that this block is signed. Okay? So what would happen if I were to change any one piece of this information? Let's say if I were to type something here. Right? The hash is going to change. And what's the chance of that if I type letters, this hash is going to start with four zeros? Pretty low. It's probably not. Right? So let's see what happens when I do that. I'm just going to say hi. Oh, look at that. Right? This hash does not start with four zeros. And so the big background here has turned red. So now you know that this block with this information in it is not a valid or a signed block. Okay? And that's where this nonce comes in. This nonce is just a number that you can set to try to find a number that fits so that this hash starts with four zeros again. Right, so how do we do that? Well, let's start with one. Does that start with no? It's three, two, so that's not one. So let's try two. FF now. Three, four, five, six. You get the idea. Like I could sit here all, there's one that starts with zero. I could sit here all day typing these numbers and trying to figure out one that actually is going to hash out to something that starts with four zeros. Gonna take a long time. So here I have my little my button. I'm sure you've been wondering what happens if I press that. So what's gonna happen when I press this my button is it's gonna run through all the numbers from one all the way up to try to find one where the hash starts with four zeros. And this process is called mining. Let's do it right now. Now it's checking all of the numbers from one all the way up. Whoop, there, now it's stopped at 59,396, and that one just happens to hash out to something that starts with four zeros, and it satisfies my little definition of what a signed block is. Okay, so that's a block. Now, can you tell me what a blockchain is? It's probably just a chain of these blocks. Well, how do you put them together? Let's do that. All right, so here's my blockchain. I have block number one. It has some kind of a nonce, just like before. There's some data area too, but then it has this previous. Here it's a bunch of zeros. Let's roll forward. So this is block two and block three and four. This blockchain has five blocks on it, right? The previous here starts with 00AE8, right? Is this number, AE8. And then this previous, you know, B90 is this one over here, B90. So you can see that each block points backwards to the one before it. You remember that the first block over here, there actually is no previous, so it's just a bunch of zeros. It's actually just a fake number. Okay, so just like we did before, what happens if I change some information here? Right, it's going to change the hash of this block, and it's going to invalidate it, right? Well, let's try that. So I'm going to hide again. Sure enough, that block is invalid. All right, just as we assumed. But what would happen? I'm going to fix that now. We'll go back to something that worked. What would happen if I change something in this block? Right, it's going to change this hash, but this hash gets copied up to this previous, so it's going to change this one too, right? So it should break both blocks. So let me try typing hi, and there, sure enough. All right. So we can go back as far as we want, you know, to some point in the past and break that block, and it'll break all the blocks since then. Everything before is still green, but this one is red. So if I wanted to, you know, change something in this blockchain, I could just go over to block number five right here. We could change it. I'll put hi, and then we could remine it, you know, and pick a different nonce. We'll do that right now. And we could essentially alter the chain. So we've done it, so we should be good now, right? All right, well, what happens if I go back in time to here and I break it here? Now I have to mine this block, which will pick a nonce that makes this block hash out to four zeros, if we can find one. Sometimes it takes a while because it's got to run through a lot of them. There it is. It found one at 138,000. All right, but this one is still broken because although this one starts with four zeros, adding the four zeros with different stuff up here still makes this block hash out incorrectly. So I also have to mine this block. All right, and that takes some amount of time. That one was a little bit quicker, and then I have to mine this block to fix it. All right, so what we're showing here is that if I go and change this last block, all I have to do is remine this block. If I go way back in time to back here and I make a change like that, I'm going to have to mine this one, this one, this one, and this one. So the more blocks that go by, the more blocks in the past that we are, the harder and harder and harder it is to make a change. And so that's how a blockchain is going to resist mutation, resist change. Okay, so now, like I did, if I do this in this block here, you can see that I've changed it to high and remined it, blah, blah, blah. How would I know that my blockchain has been remined? All right, let's take a look at that. I'm gonna hit this little distributed thing. So now we have a distributed blockchain. It looks exactly like the last blockchain, okay, up to five. But this is peer A, the first peer. If we go down here, you can see here's peer B, and it happens to have an exact copy of the blockchain. There's actually also a peer C down here, right? And this could go on forever. There's many, many peers out on the internet, and they all have a complete copy of the blockchain. So in this case, if I look at this hash, it's 00E4B, right? If I go down to this one, I notice it also has E4B. If I go down to this last one, it has E4B, so they must be identical. And I'm gonna demonstrate that by going here and typing something, I'll type hi again, and then I will remine this block. And I've got some other number, now let's put some other number up here. So I should be able to mine this block. Okay, now all the chains are green, right? They're all green. However, this chain says the last hash is E4B. The bottom one says that too, E4B. And this middle one here says 4CAE. So I know just by glancing at this one little hash that something is wrong in this blockchain, even though all of the hashes start with four zeros. I know that this one is different. And it's different because I have two. It's essentially two against one. We're a little democracy here, right? This guy argues that it's E4B. This guy argues that it's 4CE, 4CA. And this one is E4B. So E4B wins. So that's how a completely distributed copy, having a copy on many different computers, they can all very quickly see if all of the blocks are identical. Remember, blockchains can have, you know, 400,000 or 500,000 blocks very easily. So rather than checking through all of them, all you really have to do is look at the hash of the most recent one, and you can see that if anything in the past, anything way back here was altered, you can tell by looking at this at the last block in this in the chain. You know, it's going to hash out to something that doesn't start with four zeros and looks very different from what the hashes on the good chains are. Okay, so that's a blockchain. That's the entire thing. There is no more to it than that. But it's kind of not really useful because we don't have something in this data area that means anything. I keep typing my name or hi, and it's kind of, that's sort of irrelevant information. What we really want is a token. So let's do a token on our blockchain. All right, now look at this. So I have this token just totally arbitrarily. I'm calling these, I guess, dollars, right? So we have $25 from Darcy to Bingley. $4.27 go from Elizabeth to Jane. You get the idea. It's basically, there's all these transactions that are happening. And I've just replaced replace the data with these transactions. And just like we saw before, you know, so there's multiple blocks here. This one has more transactions. It doesn't matter how many transactions there are. There can be many, or there can be few, or none. If we keep going forward in here, just like we saw before, if we go down, we notice we have all these other copies of the same blockchain, right? So now here's where the immutability is important. If I change something back here, you'll notice that this is you know, A7FC, blah, blah, blah. It's something else. So it's something different than what's down here. So in this way, I mean, it's very important that if I were to go back in time and change some value, that we would notice. It's very important with money that you don't lose track. And that's the whole point of using a blockchain here. This is the whole point of resisting any kind of modifications, you know, of things that have happened in the past. So that's the reasoning behind using a blockchain to remember tokens. Now, one thing I would mention here is that we're not listing, you know, Darcy has $100 and he's giving 25 of it to Bingley. The only thing we're saying is Darcy gives 25 to Bingley. We're not remembering a bank account balance. We're only remembering money movements. So this begs the question, does Darcy have $25? Well, we have a problem here in this version of the blockchain. We don't actually know if Darcy has $25. So let's look at a Coinbase transaction. So if we look back here, Coinbase, we're going to add a Coinbase transaction to our blocks. And this is very similar to what we've seen before, but we're just adding a Coinbase at the top. And what that's saying is we're going to invent $100 out of thin air and give it to Anders. And there's no transactions in this block because nobody had any money previous to this. In the next block, another $100 comes out of nowhere and goes to Anders. I'm a fan. I love it, right? I'll take $100. Now we have some transactions. You can see that they're all from Anders. They're all from me because I'm the only one who has any money at this point. So I'm sending 10 of my dollars to Sophie. Do I have $10? Yeah, I do. I look back and I see that this Coinbase transaction has given me 100, so I have at least 10 and I can send it on. And you add all these up and they don't go over 100, and it follows sort of a basic rule of a currency. Like, you can't invent it out of thin air. You can't create money out of thin air. Dispersion is controlled. So now, if we look at this blockchain that we've created, and we zip forward in time, and we notice that we see that Jackson is giving Alexa $2. And so does Jackson actually have $2 to give Alexa? Well, we go back to the block before, and we see that Emily, who had gotten $10 from Anders, gave $10 to Jackson. And so Jackson does have the money. So we can just go backwards and find that out. That's actually one of the benefits of having a previous here. It's easy to go backwards. We just look for the block that looks like that, that has that hash, and here it is right here. Right? So you points to blocks back in time and allows us to trace the provenance of any coin that we want. So that's a basic blockchain, and we're running a currency on top of it. And as you know, blockchains are, there are many copies. Everybody has a copy of it, so if we mutate you know, this and make it $6, these go invalid. It does not agree with these blockchains down here, these copies of the same blockchain down here. So this resists tampering, which is what you want for a currency. It works very well for things that are small and transactional like this. I'll go ahead and fix that. And they're just a very efficient way to handle agreement on what has happened in the past. It's kind of this immutable history that goes down with time. So that's a basic blockchain and a token on it. We're glossing over some main points, but if you dig into the demo and click through these things and play around with it, you get a better and better idea of how this works. There will be a part part two, where we go into a little bit more detail about how the transactions are created. Till then.
Awesome, what do you guys think of that?
Sounds good, yeah.
Easy to follow? Yeah, so this guy actually does have the part two up on his YouTube, and his website also exists, which we'll send to Michael, so that if you guys want to play around with it in your own free time, you're more than welcome to mess around and change the inputs yourself and see how these things interact to real systems. Because I feel like one of the things that's really hard when learning something is the gap between actually interacting with it and just learning about it in an abstract sense. So being able to play with it, especially with things that are digital native, is really helpful for learning. So.
Do you guys have any questions that come from this video?
So every transaction requires a remining, or I should say just a mining?
Correct, yes. So for those blocks to be created, someone has to go through and find this nonce to then create a hash that is valid for whatever the network agrees upon is the difficulty.
And that's the small fee that I pay if I do a transaction.
Correct. And yeah, so that goes to whoever.
Block is a bunch of transactions. Yeah. You should explain that that's how cryptocurrency funds it exists.
Exactly, yes. So with a traditional currency, like a fiat currency, the US dollar, an entity like, you know, the Federal Reserve prints a bunch and sends it out into circulation. You know, they might tell some banks, hey, you have $1 billion in your balance when they bail them out, or they might tell, print out some actual notes and send them out to their various banks in the system. In the case of a cryptocurrency or a crypto asset, whether its purpose is a currency or not, you create these things per the network protocol. So we talked a little bit about that Coinbase transaction. So there's this idea specific to Bitcoin, the initial Bitcoin blocks would actually award 50 Bitcoin to whoever successfully found the mining block. So not only would that person collect the fees, as you mentioned, that anyone else included with their transaction, they would get 50 out of thin air, completely. The system, however, is designed so that as time goes on, less and less get created out of thin air, so that there's a finite maximum supply that can be issued, at least specifically with Bitcoin. With Ethereum, there is no cap on maximum supply, but there's stuff that's being discussed about that currently. But ultimately, that control rate of emission basically means that you have a guarantee as far as the inflation rate goes when it comes to your cryptocurrency. So you can trust that your money is not going to be devalued by, you know, say, Federal Reserve instituting TARP and printing out a metric shitload of money and really inflating the system and causing your valuations to go down. So you have that security because this network agrees on, we're only going to create so much out of thin air, and we're going to create it on a scheduled rate, and we're only going to award it to people who help the network by aggregating those blocks and finding that number and adding it to the chain. So it's a really interesting innovation from a, you know, moral hazard perspective, because no one person has the ability to just print money out of thin air. Everyone agrees on who gets to exercise that power and when they get to exercise it, which is a really important point that makes these crypto asset systems very anti-fragile.
Are you talking about sustainability of proof of work?
We can talk about it, yes. I think that's a really important point that we'll touch on a little bit with the Ethereum piece. So to kind of give some context,
really
we're
quick,
like, yeah.
Any more questions about the video?
Cool.
We were going to do a recap even though we kind of recap, blockchain is a global ledger with rules for modifying it. Blocks contain data. And we link blocks in a chain to show history. It's kind of the basics.
So it's very important to keep this idea of a general blockchain separate from the specific things, because Bitcoin itself, which I'm sure most of you have heard of, was the first cryptocurrency. And that was in the sense that it used blockchain for money. It used this idea that we can invent this money out of thin air, we can control its emission rate in a fixed and predictable way, and we can then, you know, transact that money back and forth with one another. So a blockchain, in its very first incarnation, Bitcoin, was used for transacting money. Now, blockchains can be used for many more things than just transacting with money, but it's very important to note that that was sort of the first killer app that really made this whole system work together. So it was the very first one. It was actually invented by an anonymous guy by the name of, the pseudonym really, of Satoshi Nakamoto. To this day, his identity remains unknown, which is actually a fairly interesting thing. It's a property of these systems that the guy who created it, no one knows who he is. So, or whether he's a he or whether he's a group of people, it could be anyone. So, it was created, just sent out to a mailing list of really interested cryptography researchers, and several people within the community picked up on it and thought it was an interesting idea, decided they would start mining on their own computers, And in the early days, you know, there were 5-6 people who had their computers set up with this program, running their mining, finding the blocks, and getting these 50 bitcoins every time they found them. What's really interesting about it is that bitcoins obviously are mined where you go through and you find that nonce to match that hash. Within the Bitcoin network, there are actually rules for adjusting how difficult that hash is. Because as you might imagine, the more computers you have on the network taking a crack at the problem, the faster and more likely it is that someone's going to find it. So what you want to do is you want to maintain this balance between how quickly things get found and how hard it is to find them based on how many people are actively on the network. So for example, you might later on in the life cycle of Bitcoin determine that so many blocks were found in such a quick interval that instead of 4 zeros at the start, we're going to redefine our rules to say 5 zeros at the start. So that might be a little harder for those computers, and that will balance out the effect of more computers doing this mining activity. The idea being that you want to get a roughly predictable enough schedule of adding these blocks to the blockchain so that people can rely on it for transactions, but you also don't want it to be so fast that everyone's just mining all the free Bitcoin out of existence instantly, and then you're left over. So Bitcoin specifically aims to have a roughly 10-minute block time. You will notice that the difficulty of those hash puzzles increases every 2016 blocks, so roughly every 2 weeks.
So the block time is when he puts mine in at the stage.
Exactly.
So that's 10 minutes.
So it would take 10 minutes on average for someone to mine the next block. And so there are various statistical proofs of this that, you know, at any given point, it takes about 10 minutes to find the next block. The idea being that hashing is memoryless, so there's some caveats there, but roughly 10 minutes for a block to be found on average. Obviously, it's a hard problem to solve, so people will solve it. Sometimes they'll find two really quickly in a row. Sometimes it'll take, you know, 20 minutes between blocks, but on average, it evens out to about 10 minutes at a time. And there are roughly 10,000 nodes on the network as of today. So there are roughly 10,000 nodes who are performing this mining operation and acting with whatever CPUs they may have. You'll actually find that with a proof-of-work system like this, and specifically with the hashing algorithm SHA-256, there was this motivation for people to write computer chips, like basically to print out new circuits, that would solve that problem faster. So maybe your normal Intel computer that you have at home doesn't solve this mining problem very fast, so a bunch of people went out and created their own integrated circuits to optimize that for solving these hash puzzles. So when you hear about like large-scale commercial miners, and oftentimes they have these application-specific integrated circuits that they've printed out specifically to solve the problem of one particular cryptocurrency. So where there's money, obviously, someone will find a way to get it cheap. Ethereum, on the other hand, is beyond money. So it's beyond money in the sense that there are very many interesting things that you can do with a blockchain beyond just transmuting money. So the best metaphor that I've heard for describing Ethereum is this idea of a world computer. So this idea that there is a computer that spans the globe with all these different nodes that are running, and you can run functions on this computer. And obviously, because of the properties of the blockchain, the things that you run on that computer are ultra secure. There's a permanent history that you have on it. And so as a result of that, it makes a very effective place to store important data. Because if you have a gigantic, and for those of you software developers in the room, you might think of like a class, like in Java. If you could have a distributed class, and you could have a history of all the times people call functions on that class, that would be a really powerful thing. Because you would be able to, in the same way with Bitcoin, you can trace back the $5, where they came from through the other people. You could trace the state of the current class back to however many people called different functions on it, mutated variables in it, added a variable to an array, deleted a variable from an array, etc. So being able to view that from the paradigm of, rather than just hosting ledgers about money in the cloud, let's stick actual code, and then let's record all those transactions for all of history. And then we can replay them and reconstruct the current state of the code so we can know what people have done. And there are a lot of very interesting things that Ethereum does to enable that. So the blockchain is recording these code in the cloud situations called smart contracts, is the word you typically hear for it. This is really the killer app number two for blockchain technology. This idea that you can create a distributed and decentralized contract that is ultra secure and that you're able to execute arbitrary functions. Ownership of Ether, so like Bitcoin, there needs to be some sort of medium of value in order to incentivize people to interact with each other. And that kind of goes more into the economic side of it versus the technical side of it. But Ether is specifically the currency of that chain, where people do have balances in Ether. And the idea that really kind of made this work together was that you need to spend some ether if you want to run a function on a smart contract. So the miners, instead of just aggregating who's paid who what, they actually will process out the code and then include sort of the result of your function. You know, if you have a function in the file that just adds 2 plus 2, and you call that function, you spend a little ether to the miner, and they will return to you 4 and say, hey, you know, 4 has come out as a result of this because you've run this contract. And there are various cryptographic ways that that's proven to have occurred correctly. So there's lots of really interesting stuff that you can do. You can create a contract to distribute tokens, which was the crux of the ICO boom, this idea that you could have a smart contract that basically had an array in it of all of these tokens. And you could assign those token balances to owners who interact with it. So that if you then bought an ERC-20 token, you can then look at the contract, reconstruct the current state of it, and see that you have a balance of X amount of that token just by querying the contract. It's a pretty cool idea. You can also create crypto assets. I'm sure some of you in the room have heard of CryptoKitties. This idea that you could, instead of just creating tokens that are sort of interchangeable, you could create unique properties, unique assets, and you can store those and track those within a smart contract as well. So imagine this like gigantic virtual broker who is tracking all the CryptoKitties, and that's this CryptoKitties contract. And it records the way you interact with it and allows you to generate new ones, to transfer ownership of your existing ones to other people, that kind of thing. And so obviously smart contracts are very important.
Crypto assets ended up turning into kind of collectibles, like CryptoKitties are a collectible. We basically use this idea for identity
projects. Yeah, so we're pretty inspired by this idea that you can just create an asset and store it in a contract. And so that kind of leads into what we did at ETH Denver here. So we're going to touch base a little bit on that.
How do you feel about Bitcoin and Ethereum? Questions? It's a lot to digest.
I had a couple of comments.
Yeah.
If you want them now.
Yeah, sure.
They're so distracting. They're cute,
yeah.
But you see that you're all out, that's cool, and forget to listen to what is being said. But, a couple of technical things. I think you pointed this out, but blockchain is really your secure data structure, right? It's immutable, auditable, it's secure, but it isn't the protocol. And so different cryptocurrencies have different protocols which handle the dollar spend and some of the other issues. And it's good to separate that because if you try and do them all together, it just gets confusing.
Absolutely.
So that helps with that. That's good. There's one more. Oh, Bitcoin really wasn't the first cryptocurrency. It was the first blockchain-based one, as far as I know. But I mean, I was looking at cryptocurrencies back in, I guess, the late 90s. So they've been around a long time, but
it was the first one to spin the Bitcoin problem.
Exactly. Blew away every other approach that we've ever tried. So that's the key thing there. So.
Yeah, and I think we should probably expand on the history a little bit to kind of like the Bitfold experiments and stuff
exactly.
like that.
Yeah.
Because those were interesting, but they didn't solve the problem of
exactly.
someone being able to, you know, potentially cheat the network.
Yeah,
right? Someone still had to audit that and verify that. So there had to be some mechanism for it. And all these various pieces kind of got invented as time went on. And this anonymous Satoshi Nakamoto character was the first one to put them all together.
Brilliant.
It's still surviving to this day. It's the longest existing one of the blockchain form, but I think it's a very, very key one.
You might point out, I don't know how deep you want to get, you just want to keep it overall. But you might explain that to query a state doesn't cost you any ether,
right.
But to change a state or report the values,
yes.
You have to spend some.
That basically
creates not a spam.
Yep. Yeah, and that's one of the nice things about it is the readability of it. So like we kind of talked about, you know, reconstructing whether Anders has $5 by going back through time to check that out. Similarly with smart contracts and Ether, that's incredibly important because you have this data structure that may have some arrays and some variables and what have you. And you want to know what the current state of that is. So if someone asks you for array element 15 in that contract, you want to be able to quickly and cheaply figure that out, because it would suck if you had to pay money for it. So reading is free, it's writing that costs money. And writing costing money also prevents people from spamming. So it prevents people from just flooding the network with a bunch of, you know, DS zero weight transactions to try to inflate the size of it, because you have to spend money in order to do so. And so that kind of goes a little bit into consensus algorithms and how those are designed. So Bitcoin, in particular, we talked about the mining, right? Where mining is the mechanism that people agree on things. People agree that a block is a block because someone has come up with a hash for it that satisfies that difficulty problem. So it's very easy for each individual to verify a block is valid, because all they do is they look at it. You can run the hash function yourself, and you can see that, hey, it starts with 4-0. It's cool. It's legit. Now, there are other alternative consensus mechanisms. In particular, with Ethereum right now, proof of stake is one that's being discussed very actively. There's a very active development community around solving the problems inherent to that. But the idea is that instead of having people compete by having lots of computing power in order to solve these mining puzzles, giving people voting power equivalent to the amount of ether they have in the network. So the idea being, maybe you can determine blocks and determine what is valid based on a vote across all the people who have stake in the network, so that that way you can figure out, okay, well, if someone, if the aggregate number of people have voted that this is valid, we consider it valid for the rules of the network. And there are a lot of caveats with that, because obviously in the case of someone owning more than half the wealth, they can just figure out and say whatever they want to be true. Much in the same way that someone who has more than half of the computers in the world mining Bitcoin could do the same. So there's arguments that maybe one is harder than the other. There's also arguments with regard to the waste of electricity, because obviously it's very expensive to have loops running and running and consuming all this power to figure out this mining process with Bitcoin specifically. Maybe staking, which doesn't require that incredibly electricity intensive process, might be a more environmentally friendly way to approach consensus mechanisms. So there are lots of interesting issues that are being solved. Ethereum in particular is trying to, currently Ethereum uses proof of work, which is this mining thing, but there are proposals for a hybrid approach, at least in the short term, eventually leading to a full proof of stake approach. But there are lots of interesting consensus mechanisms across the whole space. There's things like delegated proof of stake, where, you know, instead of you necessarily voting directly with your stake, you could nominate someone else to be your representative. Sounds an awful lot like we're redesigning government structures.
Yeah.
But pretty interesting research that's going on with that, and making sure that these systems are secure and robust, so that that way when people participate in them in the future, they can be assured that their value, their assets that they have tied up in these chains, are actually secure and not able to be trivially stolen. That leads into our little hackathon thing here. I'm a little less bearded than I was back then. But I'll let Becca talk a little bit about ETH Denver and sort of what we did.
Sure. So, like I said, there's a group of us at work who got very into cryptocurrencies, spent a lot of our free time and work time thinking and talking about them. So I think Dylan was the one who found out about ETH Denver, sent out a group to our cryptocurrency channel, inviting everyone to participate. This is the group that wins. It's Dylan and I, our co-worker Delano and Yuba. Only Delano and Dylan worked on the same team. The rest of us had never worked together. None of us had ever touched Solidity or built an app using the blockchain, but we were super interested, so we just thought it would be a great opportunity to learn. There's a great group of people at ETH Denver, very passionate people, so we were very excited. Our project called Gas Buffalo Robots. One of our coworkers had an idea. As you know, with Ethereum, you have to use gas. And, well, you explain it
to me. Yeah, so really, one of the things that's kind of hard for people to understand when they aren't super familiar with contracts and running code in general, is this idea of spending gas. So in order for you to execute a function on a smart contract, you basically have to pay for, in essence, every line of code that you run. Because every line of code that a miner is running is a line that they could be running for someone else who paid them more. So you have to basically allot a certain amount of ether in your transaction to pay for running each of those lines of code. And with programming, and with software in general, you don't always know beforehand exactly what execution path your function call is going to take. So you don't know if that function call is going to then lead on to calling, you know, 70 or 80 lines of code, it's going to call 20,000 lines of code, et cetera. And it would be kind of insane to make someone who's using the network figure that out for themselves and budget appropriately. So what you do is you set a gas limit saying that I'm willing to pay up to this amount. And then you set a gas price, which is the price per line code that you're willing to pay. So that way, you know, you can set a maximum threshold on how much code can be executed. So if you call a contract by accident that has an infinite loop, you can only lose the maximum that you set to it. And so that's something that's really hard for some people to learn, and especially with a lot of these more complicated smart contracts. So there are smart contracts that act as basically like stock brokerages in the sense of, you know, Ether Delta, where you exchange tokens across different people, which requires calling a lot of different other contracts, which can be pretty expensive. And stuff like that is very hard for a new user to understand because they don't know what they should budget, because they don't necessarily know what these things cost. One of the things that really, really sucks is when you submit a transaction to the Ethereum blockchain and you run out of gas. Because then the miner just stops executing. Once you get to the point where you paid your maximum amount and there's still more code to go, miner says, the heck with this, I'm going to run another transaction. You've already paid me your maximum amount. Cuts it off and moves on to the next one. So in that case, you just get a result that says, hey, your smart contract call failed. Tough luck. Try again next time. And that's not a really great user experience. Yeah, exactly. Something that can be frustrating. So we wanted to solve that problem in a kind of fun and silly way. So gas goes a robot space invented.
So a couple quick things. Long story short, if you don't give them enough money, like, you lose everything you just tried to do. Another thing about this project is we didn't want to go too big or fancy. We didn't want to try and overwork ourselves. We just wanted to create an application that worked from start to finish and did exactly what we wanted it to do. And I think that's
Yeah, and it was really fun to demo too. You know, the ETH Denver group of people was just a very collaborative and open and, you know, very interesting group. And I think that's fairly true of all people in the cryptocurrency space, is that they're at this point in time very open-minded and very willing to collaborate and help out. Everyone has a passion for people's security. And I think that's something that you don't usually see those factors together in the same sort of industry for long. You know, once mass adoption comes and more people are involved in the space, obviously, the character will probably change a little bit, but I think this, you know, early character of the space has been incredible, and it was fantastic to get to meet so many cool people and talk about stuff. So we actually have spun up a local Ethereum blockchain here. So this is a series of tools developed by a company Consensus. This is Ganache, which is part of the Truffle suite of Ethereum Solidity development tools. And this is actually a graphical interface for running a local blockchain, a local, you know, fake Ethereum testnet blockchain, which is really cool because prior to, you know, pretty much 2017, almost all this stuff was very much exclusively command line. So if you weren't familiar with the command prompt of the computer, it'd be a little harder to get involved in some of these things than it is now with these really powerful graphical tools. So what you can see here is that in this local blockchain that we've created, we've deployed two different contracts, and we've called their sort of initializers on them. And then we also made a contract call here, and then did a value transfer operation. We're gonna kind of walk through doing a repeat of these here. So one of the things that sucks is you get a transaction that runs out of gas. You wanna get some of your money back. You don't really have a way to get your money back because the protocol doesn't exactly let you go to the miner and say, hey, get it back to me, please. You're pretty please. I'm asking nicely. So we thought it would be really cool to commemorate your failures with a unique crypto asset, crypto collectible. We call him a gas guzzler robot because he sucked down all your gas. And if you can prove that you submitted a transaction that ran out of gas, you can collect your assigned robot for that transaction, and then you can potentially sell him to someone else who might find some fascination. There have been some pretty colossal screw-ups in Gasland, especially in the Ethereum world. And so we figured, you know, let's make the monster even cooler, the greater the magnitude of your error. So that way, you know, the really cool ones are the most collectible and will probably give you the better likelihood of recouping some of the money that you lost. So, yeah, exactly. So we're going to run a Truffle script here that's just going to submit a transaction to this local blockchain that runs out of gas. It just calls a function called infinite loop, which is going to run through here. And you'll see this contract transaction get mined in a second here. And this contract call runs.
We also had 36 hours to create this app and haven't really touched it since.
Exactly.
So it is like a product that we made in 36 hours with like overnights and stuff.
Yeah, very, very little sleep was involved, so forgive any rough edges here.
One of our team members had just had a baby, so
yeah,
he was not there very often.
He was very freaked out.
Well, he wasn't there the
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Probably prefer that environment to the other one, you know, a little less crack. Well, I don't know, maybe less crack. But this transaction has this transaction hash here. And so you can see that this transaction used the maximum amount of gas. The gas limit matches the gas used. And the transaction, if you look at here, it actually does return, hey, the EVM failed, out of gas. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this transaction hash, and we're going to go to our React app that we created. So Becca's the front-end expert, lots of React expertise. I'm more of a back-end guy. I can't draw a straight line with a ruler kind of person. So it was awesome to get to work together with people across different skill sets. So we create this little dialogue where you can pop the hash in here, and it will verify that it, in fact, was a transaction that failed and is valid. So we get to potentially claim sad honey here. So we're going to claim sad honey with MetaMask. So what this does is this just pops up a tool for us to interact with the blockchain. That's what MetaMask is. It's a way of interacting with the Ethereum blockchain for those of you who aren't aware. It's like a nice little browser extension. You can add Chrome to interact with Ethereum. So we're going to submit this transaction. So our gas limit, we're going to keep it relatively high. Our gas price, we don't have to worry about the current level of network usage because this is a local network, so we'll just leave it at one. Submit this transaction here, and you'll see that when we go to the list of transactions, there will be a value transfer transaction that will pop up once it gets mined. So it's doing this little auto mining here. And once we have proof of it, we'll be able to actually go and see the guys that we have claimed. So now we go back to our robots here, and you can see that we have two of these guys. We had the one that we claimed earlier, and then this one that we just claimed now. Little sad honey belongs to us on the blockchain, and we could possibly resell them for some of our money back. Probably not our dignity back, but at least some of them.
Yeah, so the idea behind this is when you get failures, it's very disappointing, so something to almost encourage you is to go to our site and enter in your hash, and you get a little cute collectible with a funny name. And the bigger the failure, like you said, the more ridiculous the robot might be. And that way you can trade them around, get more money for your crazy robots. We were thinking if you try and claim a robot, and then on that claim fail it, it's like a double fail. So that might be something kind of weird. Yeah, so it's kind of just a fun little idea that makes things simpler and nicer.
Yep. Really, when it comes to driving that next level of adoption of blockchain and crypto technology, it's about understanding that people are using it, and to make things that people do. And I think that was one of the key lessons that we learned from this and from showing it to people. You know, it would almost universally get people to smile and think, oh, that's kind of neat. And that's a really cool thing that we have the power to do in this space, is to make people passionate, to make people excited. So that's about all we got as far as that goes. Do you guys have any further kind of questions for us, clarifications, anything like that? Sure.
So is Ether always required? Let me give you an example. So I'm going to do an ICO called Robert's Coin.
Yep.
And I'm going to use the Ethereum technology to do that. Is Ether still required in that scenario, or am I creating my own currency that's just simply using Ethereum blockchain technology?
So in order for you to deploy any sort of smart contract to the Ethereum blockchain, you have to pay Ethereum to get it actually into the chain. And in addition, if you're going to use sort of a standard ICO template, so a lot of people have done ICOs beforehand and kind of created the template for the smart contract to power them. It's known as the ERC-20 token standard, which is sort of, there's a couple of additional ones on top of it that have some more complexity and additional features. But in order for you to then issue those assets on the chain, someone has to spend Ether in order to claim their tokens out of the contract. So ultimately, when you do an ICO, when you see these ICOs that, you know, raise $30 million, that's $30 million of Ether that they raised, because they set up a contract, and then people were able to basically independently make claims to the contract to buy those, you know, securities or whatever they may be at their offered price for the contract. So yes, to answer your question, you would need to spend the Ether to submit the contract to the chain, and you would also receive the payments for those tokens in that ICO in ETH, which of course you can then convert to whatever currency you like, but that can cause some issues, especially if you have a lot of ETH that you don't want to work at the same time. It's a little thing called slippage in trading land that may come to mind that might want you to kind of ration that out a little bit.
And if I don't want to use Ether, then I'm creating my own crypto.
Well, so correct, but people are going to have to spend Ether to send their own crypto to each other because they're sending it on top of the Ethereum blockchain. And Ether is sort of the native coin of that chain. So in order to interact with that chain at all, you need to have it. But
is it fair to say that if you use the Ether contracts, then you don't have to write source code?
Exactly.
If you write your own cryptocurrency, you're writing it.
Right. So you can rely on the backs of basically the people who are keeping the Ethereum blockchain secure. They're already doing that. You don't have to worry about getting a bunch of people to download your software and run it at the same time in order to create that network where you have enough people that someone can't cheat. So a lot of projects have actually used Ether in sort of a two-step process, where they've used Ethereum to launch their tokens and then built their own tech on the side. And then they arrange basically a snapshot date where they say, hey, on June 1st, we're going to freeze all the tokens and stop them from being removed. And whatever tokens you have then, you can redeem publicly on our new chain. And so that's been an interesting way that people who want to roll their own technology, but still do the fundraising now while it's hot and relatively unregulated, have made that their approach to it. So ultimately, with a lot of these ICOs, that's been made possible by smart contracts. So kind of prior to that, you had a lot of people who would launch their new software and you just had to convince a bunch of people to download it and start mining it and find value in it, which was kind of hard for all but a few of those earlier generation coins. And there were also controversies too, because if someone started it up and mined all the coins right at the very start, then you had an unequal wealth distribution and people wouldn't necessarily think it was fair and might affect the value of the coin and so on. And so the Ethereum ICO process has ended up being a more acceptable alternative, at least in a lot of respects, risk reward wise for people, because you don't have to rely, like you said, on having everyone download your software. It's all on Ethereum. And that already exists and is proven and tested and secure. Yeah.
How many images have you created for these robots?
So there are a lot of them. So we actually use an interesting website called robohash.org,
nice.
Where we actually feed a hash into it and it generates a unique robot.
Nice.
Because none of us were particularly artistic.
So really, then, okay.
Yep.
Okay.
So
really, we just wanted something kind of simple to get along. We couldn't, create our own graphics in 36 hours for the crazy robots or anything.
No, it was amazing. You found, what was your Google search like?
It was very specific.
Literally that like.
It was caffeine filled and extremely specific.
Yeah.
How about the name? Same type of thing?
That's just an array. I mean, first and last, it's just a bunch of goofy words.
I've seen this project, not by name generators.
Mm-hmm.
All that.
Yeah.
How long is your array name?
I don't even think it's that long.
I think we have like 10 first and 10 last, and it just crosses them.
It's like decent, I'd say. That's fun. I don't remember
where it was.
Many months ago.
I saw a robot ID there in the last one.
So you're feeding the plus IDs and stuff.
Down at the bottom? Like that? Size, key.
it was just up here somewhere.
And that's one of the really cool things too about smart contracts. So for example, the contract that we created that tracks all these robots and tracks who owns the robots, it keeps track of the hash of the transaction that it was created from. So that way someone can't go in and claim the same thing twice. Yeah, so we've got some fun names in there. It tracks the name of the blockchain, it tracks the size of gas that was used in the transaction. So that way you have sort of all this metadata related to it. And it's pretty easy to see how this technology could be used for tracking of all kinds of assets. I mean, it's not far-fetched to say that perhaps you could track real estate on the blockchain, where perhaps you put in some identifiers about what property and maybe the lat long or a geofence around some area and track that in a decentralized way like this, where you can have, instead of the county recorder, you can have this distributed network all around the world that isn't able to be destroyed if the county recorder's office burns down. So there's probably lots of really interesting things that you can continue to do with smart contracts, and especially with these kind of custom assets you're able to create.
This was very fun for us when we were delusional.
Yeah. Question?
I was just curious, you guys said no.
There's another website that if you guys are interested in kind of following a more directed tutorial, you didn't really have the time to get through it. We heard about it like 3 hours in, and we're like, oh, that's a really cool idea. I wish we would have done that because we're committed to this path right now. But it's called Crypto Zombies, if you Google it. And it's a very interesting way to sort of follow along with how you would deploy a smart contract, how you would actually make that smart contract do something cool. So if you're a technical person interested in this, it's a really interesting interactive learning resource. And that's something that I think is important when you are learning something, just interacting with it. So I'm going to just walk to the top there. And it's made by these guys, Boom Network. So.
Yeah, it's super helpful. I'm not a developer at all. And like I went through the first couple of lessons and I was reading through the ERC 721 standard, and it really helped me understand a lot of it. So I would highly recommend the two sources as well.
The first couple lessons are really good, and then they get to the point where you ran the front end and like, here's a bunch of code copy.
Yeah.
I'm disappointed about that. And it's not done. I think they've got 6 or 7 done, and they're like, we'll email you when we get another one up. So it's a work
in progress. Okay.
Yeah.
I mean,
far,
that's
right.
Interesting, though, right?
Yeah. I'm actually looking for some, I mean, if anybody can help me out on actually some resources like that around education, because I have the University of New Mexico wants to create an accredited program for teaching stuff
awesome.
And making it so that people can go out and get jobs doing this. So we can really create an ecosystem, and people that want to have developers, we can train them up and get them trained up. So if anybody's got any help, shoot me up.
Definitely.
I was just going to mention that, I mean, I think it's true that a lot of the tools are kind of rough because the system's so new.
Right.
The Truffle Suite website has pretty good tutorials.
Unbelievable.
That's how I sort of did my first Solidity smart contract, basically.
Yeah, and that's where we got that program that we kind of show on our local computer to run like a local blockchain, that Ganache program. Super cool.
And then after that, like, it's also true that depending on what computing, or not computing, but what like language platform you're most familiar with, like Java, whatever, there tends to be like a sort of de facto suite of tools for each of those platforms that people use, so it's good to look for that too. This is probably better to start with, but once you do that.
Right. Yeah. Like, I think there's actually a VVM implementation being done in Python as well that they were talking about, which is pretty sweet. So, yeah, Solidity is kind of Java C++-esque in some senses. It's like almost halfway in between with the amount of memory referencing you have to deal with, but Python obviously has an ecosystem.
Solidity is its own language?
Yeah,
or?
Solidity is its own language. It just has some similarities in terms of structure.
And you learned it in 36 hours?
Well, I think that the similarity, it's a little less impressive than it might sound at first, because there's a lot of similarity to existing languages. And so, you know, when it's almost like how Italian and Spanish are relatively similar, there's kind of that same thing going on between Solidity and Java.
And I think another thing we had talked about is because we all have a background in software engineering, and we've been doing it for a while, we could kind of pick up on this kind of stuff quickly. And I think that's why we were successful, is that we could pick it up quick, like it's not a language.
Another resource that I'd recommend is called Ethernaut, and you go through and try to hack contracts that have vulnerabilities. So that's a pretty...
Is it at Zeppelin's?
Yeah, it's Zeppelin's. Sweet. So that's a great resource if you're like trying to up your security in your smart contract. And you just like go through the levels that they have. It's also very great.
Yeah, there are some pretty famous bugs that have happened with Ethereum contracts and have created a little bit of controversy around how they were resolved. Well, I'll leave that discussion for another day, but it's very important to make sure your smart contracts don't fall prey to code errors. You know, the protocol itself doesn't have any problems with it, but oftentimes when you have humans writing human code on something, they might miss some key things and maybe get 600 million ether locked up.
When you had that, you showed that demo that was part of the video, is that on the... Was there a website for that?
Yes, actually. So
I missed it.
So we'll go to that. So it's at Anders.com/blockchain. And then you can kind of click into each of the different pieces. So he has the part one here, which is super, that's the video that we sat and watched through. There's also a part two for anyone who's interested. following it a little more deeply about sort of how we actually do the encryption piece of it, because obviously you don't want Kim Jong-un stealing our communications.
We had also, in our demo to our company, we used his examples here and tried to make up little funny things, like used people in the company's names, like gives $200 or something. And then that way we could get people to kind of understand like what should be happening here. It, we put it in simple enough terms that people understood and they laughed a little bit. But this was a great way to kind of mess with it and understand it more.
Yeah, being able to play with it makes it real. And that's something that is very key for the program.
Does it go into Merkle trees or anything like that?
I think his more advanced one touches on it, but I don't know specifically. I haven't seen his second one in a while. I'm sure there are resources for sort of Merkle trees. Yeah.
I have a comment and a question.
Absolutely.
My comment is, I'm in commercial real estate, that's my real estate.
Oh, exciting.
And so we have to cooperate with our competitors to a certain point to get a deal done. And I think it's amazing the amount of information that you're sharing with each other with, you know, for no charge. And it's like, you know, we would dig deep in to find a lot of information on a certain property or whatever. And we would hide that from our, you know, competitor. So I think that's just, this is such a new experience. It's really awesome that you're sharing your ideas and information. And then the question is, what is it we can do to help you? What are you looking for from this group tonight?
Yeah, I think really it's about education at its core, you know, getting people excited and enthusiastic about really the world-changing potential that this technology has. And I mean, ultimately, the creative ideas that are going to take this to the next level, the third killer app for blockchain, whatever that may be, is going to be thought of by someone. And so the more people are thinking about it, thinking about how it might apply to their daily lives, who have some sort of connection to it, or following the space, following how it develops, the better, really, because the bigger the company, you know, the bigger the source of ideas. So if you're in good company with all these folks in this room, feel the chumminess and the camaraderie. It's a great space to be in for that reason, because you can really source those ideas from a broader range of perspectives.
And for me, when I was first getting into this, it was nearly impossible to find a tutorial or like an article from the beginning to try and explain everything about this. So I do think trying to get people like you guys who are in this industry, you know everything about the blockchain, to be able to explain to people in simple terms what this is and what this means, and for people who don't know what they're doing, to be able to learn it in an easy way. So really, like Dylan said, it's just exposure and getting more people to know about it.
Yeah, and invest in the space too. You know, it never hurts to throw some money at it. Especially with the silliness of the growth of the market cap as it's happened. It's been pretty wild to see how people are continuing to value this highly. You see speculators looking at things like Bitcoin as, hey, wait, that's actually more scarce than gold, so maybe I should treat it like gold from an investment asset perspective. You see stuff like Ether being referred to as digital oil, in the sense that it's the oil that powers all these computer programs to run in a distributed and secure, safe way. And so these different crypto assets that have been created are really compelling, and who knows what the next one is or how the current ones are going to evolve.
You know, they're starting to show the Bitcoin prices at the bottom of the news, like,
really?
Like on the financial section.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like, you know, they're talking about IBM stock and all that kind of thing. And they got the Bitcoin price.
That's wild. Super exciting. That's going to be really exciting times to see adoption sort of cross the chasm from the early adopter folk to more of the mainstream. And kind of understanding those fundamentals should hopefully prepare you at least to interact in a world 10 years in the future where maybe some of this stuff is more direct. You know, maybe you're saving some of your money for it because the US dollar has collapsed or something. Who knows? It's always a nice insurance policy there.
Cool. Thank you so much, guys. Let's give them a round of applause.
Does anyone have any announcements of any events or anything that are
want like a specific link and didn't get a capture of it, happy to send it your own.
It's also all recorded and will be on YouTube as well, so plenty of opportunity to find it. Does anyone else have any announcements? I have some announcements. There next Wednesday in Denver at 6 p.m., there is an event that's being put on by the Boulder blockchain, and that's for the World Crypto Network. There are a bunch of YouTubers who are very into the space, and so Vortex will be there, Andy Hoffman, Jack Mallers, who made the Lightning wallet, the Zap wallet, I think it is, for the Lightning Network, Adam Meister and Mike Krieger. And then this Ethereum Boulder, the next time we meet up, it will be more technical. It's going to be Jordan Earls, who is the co-founder and lead developer for Quantum, which is an interesting project that allows you to basically, you can like move your smart contract from Ethereum to their platform. And he's going to be talking about the x86 implementation of their virtual machine. So that should be super interesting. We'll be in the atrium, and then that will be recorded as well. And we are going to the Attic Bar next door if you would like to join us to hang out. And let's give Beck and Dylan one more round of applause. Making presentations is really time consuming and everyone is busy, so definitely appreciate them doing that. And finally, make sure you have all of your things, because if you don't, if you leave something behind, I don't know how to get it to you, so you won't see it again.
Thank you guys.
Thank you guys so much.
Stop. Oh, I have to pee.